sulfonylurea urea and enhanced insulin secretion irrespective of the level of the blood glucose, and hence can cause hypoglycemia and weight gain. Then came the era of DPP-4 inhibitors. In year 2006, first DPP-4 inhibitor was approved. These drugs amplify glucose-stimulated insulin secretion. Agents in this class do not cause hypoglycemia and are weight neutral because of the glucose-dependent nature of the insulin secretion. In year 2011, a star among DPP-4 inhibitors was approved. That is, linagliptin was approved. It's a star among DPP-4 inhibitors because of its unique properties. One of the unique properties is that it has got negligible renal excretion. Only 5% of the drug is renally excreted. Hence, it can be used in all stages of chronic kidney disease. To tell us about its advantages over other DPP-4 inhibitors, we have today with us two stalwarts in their field. The first speaker is Dr. Sushil Chauhan. He needs no introduction to this August gathering. He is an eloquent and powerful speaker. All of us know about his dedication to the cause and his strong organization capabilities. Besides this, he is an excellent human being and has personal equation with all members of our group. Earlier, he has served in many important positions. He was medical officer in cardiology at Subsurban Hospital and consultant physician at a reputed hospital in Saudi Arabia. He was a consultant cardiologist and in charge coronary care unit at Shriram Heart Institute and Research Center, Kirtinagar. Now I request Dr. Chauhan to enlighten us with his words of brief wisdom. Dr. Chauhan, please.
Thank you. Am I audible to everyone, sir? Dr. Anil, am I audible?
Yes, please, sir.
Sir, first of all, thank you so much for your kind words. And as usual, my partner in crime today is Dr. Sanjeev Gulati, my best friend across the spectrum when it comes to nephrology. And thank you so much for accepting this offer of moderating this session for both me and Sanjeev. Dr. Anil sir, it was my dream that you moderate our session.
It's my honor, sir. Thank you very much.
At least it's live. And it's for a very important cause, actually. It's for this wonderful molecule, linagliptin, of which actually I have become a fan over the years, and Dr. Sanjeev Gulati will vouch for it, that it's one drug, as he says, you know, fill it, shut it, and forget it. So it's that kind of molecule. So we'll be talking about some of the mythbusters about linagliptin in metabolic perspective. It is an important arsenal in the overall scenario of controlling diabetes, and especially when it comes to so many variables and so many conditions that surround diabetes that we have to be careful about. So a molecule which does not require too much monitoring, too much flexing, and too much monitoring, you know, is a really wonderful molecule. So we'll go ahead and present this webinar on that mode. And what are the mythbusters about linagliptin, and what are the advantages, and what does it offer to us in the overall scenario of diabetes control? So, as you are aware, friends, that diabetes has become a pandemic as much as COVID has become a pandemic. The world is going to see a 51% increase in the overall diabetes population by the year 2045, which is going to swell to 70 crores by 2045. It is important to mention that Europe has already peaked, and Africa is going to peak by that time with an increase of more than 143% increase in cases of diabetes. If diabetes was not pain enough, we are now faced with the pandemic of COVID-19, and on March 11, 2020, the World Health Organization declared the novel coronavirus, the COVID-19, as a global pandemic and classified the outbreak as an international emergency. These figures are old. It would be pertinent to revise these figures. We have lost more than 4 lakh people, sadly, in our country. More than 4 million people have been lost worldwide. So you can understand the magnitude of the problem. And you very well know the second wave, how much sad and how much imposing it was in Delhi itself, with people dying in their cars, in ambulances, outside the hospitals, people carrying lots of money, but no beds available in the hospital, and no oxygen available at home, cylinders being sold in black. Our health system came under a total collapse, and no less a person than our own health minister paid the price for it. I didn't want to say it, but I think it has to be said in as many words. So mortality is higher in patients with comorbidities and diabetes. It was a seminal paper published in Lancet. The pandemic originated in Wuhan, and epidemiological and clinical characteristics show only 99 cases of 2019 novel coronavirus pneumonia in Wuhan, China. It showed us that people with cardiovascular and cerebrovascular disease and people with cardiovascular disease and diabetes had the maximum mortality. It is a paper by none other than our own prima donna of endocrinology, Dr. Amrish Mittal. Hospital admissions for COVID-19, clinical outcomes by diabetes status. So whether it comes to severe cases, mortality, inhaled oxygen therapy, ICU admissions, inotropic support or renal replacement therapy, people with diabetes had the maximum burden of all this as compared to non-diabetics. And it will be important to revise some of the important molecules that we usually use in diabetes, especially in view of the COVID-19 pandemic. So what about metformin? So metformin, you will have to understand that dehydration, lactic acidosis, if patients are dehydrated, so patients should follow the sick day rules. During illness, renal function should be carefully monitored because of high risk of disease or acute kidney injury. I would like to summarize this slide by saying that DPP-4 inhibitors are the only group of drugs which are generally well-tolerated and can be continued from insulin. Insulin therapy should not be stopped. Regular self-monitoring of blood glucose every 2 to 4 hours should be done. And carefully adjust regular insulin appropriate to reach therapeutic goals according to the diabetic type, comorbidities and health status. So what we have to be careful about? We have to be careful about metformin, SGLT2 inhibitors and GLP-1 analogs. All very encouraging molecules in themselves, but we have to be careful when we are co-treating them with the COVID-19. So what about the patients of COVID-19 and patients of diabetes? So when do you start them on oral anti-diabetic drugs? Only if their pre-meal blood glucose is between 150 to 180, that is after admission, and post-meal blood glucose is between 200 to 250, and you are waiting for an endocrinologist or a physician to come and see the patient. If there is an anticipated delay in consulting these two people, then start them on metformin, either immediate or sustained release 500 mg twice a day. And what is the second drug of choice? The gliptin. So what do you start with? You can start with either vildagliptin 50 BD or sitagliptin 100 mg OD or linagliptin 5 mg once a day. You can also start with the cheaper, the poor man's DPP-4 inhibitor, the linagliptin 20 mg once a day, provided the patient meets all the following criteria. And what are these criteria? Pre-meal blood glucose is between 150 and 180. And or post-meal blood glucose is between 200 and 250, and the other criteria as mentioned in the busy chart that we have shown on the left side, and that is if your blood glucose is between 150 and 180 and your random blood glucose is 200 to 250, order for an HbA1c. If it is in the diabetic range, then you start them. If you want to start them on oral medications, metformin or DPP-4 inhibitors, there is no mention of SGLT2 inhibitors, GLP-1 analogs or other drugs or even insulin. So we have a prototype patient here. Complained of mild progressive dyspnea on exertion and fatigue for the past 4 weeks. History of chronic illness, type 2 diabetes for 3 years, hypertension, dyslipidemia for 7 years. There's past history of recurrent urogenital infections, no family history of CVD. Presently, the patient is taking metformin, optimum dose, 1000 BD. At all was set in 21 days, telmisartan 40 mg OD. Examination 72 kg, BMI 23.5, and blood pressure is okay. Clinical examination, there is bilateral pedilumer, slightly elevated JVP. Baseline lab findings, glycemic profile, HbA1c not ideally controlled, more than 7.8%. Fasting plasma glucose 135, and fasting and PPG 210. Kidney function serum creatinine 1.4, not ideal. Dr. Sanjeev Gulati will be able to better highlight this. Urine albumin creatinine ratio of 108 mg per gram of creatinine. And eGFR of 14, 31 ml. So what I want to tell you is that if you see creatinine levels, it would seem that the SGC is not having a big problem. But actually, if you calculate the eGFR, you would find that the patient is almost in stage 3. So what should be our approach to reach glycemic target? Considering renal and cardiovascular comorbidity, what would you like to do? Would you like to add a sulfonylurea or a DPP-4 inhibitor? And what is our perception? Our perception is always that the efficacy of sulfonylurea is much higher than DPP-4 inhibitors. So let's see the evidence. Right. So this is a seminal paper which was published in Lancet in 2012. It was from Galvich et al. And it was much before Carolina was undertaken and published. And it was head-to-head comparison between lanagliptin and glimepiride combined with metformin. So starting at a baseline of 7.4, if you see even at 104 weeks, the HbA1c with lanagliptin that we achieved was actually lower when compared with glimepiride and metformin. So what was our perception? Our perception of this is that a sulfonylurea is a better bet along with metformin as compared to any other molecule. Given the fact that glimepiride is a great secretagogue above and is almost equal to insulin as far as HbA1c lowering capacity is concerned. But this seminal paper in Lancet in 2012 showed us that actually it is the other way around. It is DPP-4 inhibitors plus metformin, which at the end of 104 weeks stood out against glimepiride and metformin combination. So what I want to tell you is that there is almost a two times possibility, twice the odds ratio that you will achieve your goals with linagliptin, with metformin as compared to glimepiride. And this has been borne out with this seminal paper which was published by Chadwick et al. In 2020. So from 2012, since 2020, there has been multiple evidence-based, robust evidence that tells us that DPP-4 inhibitors, along with either in monotherapy or along with metformin, score much over as with glimepiride and metformin combination. So we have a head-to-head comparison here in Carolina. The very important thing is that when you achieve these HbA1c goals, so what is the price that you are paying? So there is a 77% lower risk of hypoglycemia when you use DPP-4 inhibitors as your primary therapy as compared to sulfonylureas for achieving the same HbA1c goals. And which is huge. 77% relative risk reduction is huge, you know, in the context of achieving HbA1c, what is the price you are paying? So Carolina showed clearly that if you use DPP-4 inhibitors, either in monotherapy or with metformin, then the risk and the price that you pay is much less as compared to glimepiride. And what about the weight loss? The overall weight loss with liraglutide as compared to glimepiride, again the same data, is about 1.5 kilograms, which is the overall scenario is a great news. You understand that if you were to use either insulin or glimepiride or any other cigarette above, the weight loss is always there. But with DPP-4, the relative weight loss that you actually have is 1.5 kilograms. Another important consideration is hypoglycemia. You know that when we use sulfonylurea or another cigarette above to achieve HbA1c goals, the problem is at the hypoglycemia. So this is numbers needed to treat, whether it is any episode of hypoglycemia, moderate or severe hypoglycemia, or hospitalization because of hypoglycemia. So the numbers needed to treat any episode of hypoglycemia as compared to glimepiride versus liraglutide is only 3. You need to treat only 3 people to achieve this goal. And to achieve moderate to severe hypoglycemia, you need to treat only 4 people. So you can understand the importance of treating your diabetic patients with liraglutide and metformin as compared to glimepiride, and there is a greater risk of hypoglycemia with glimepiride as compared to liraglutide. Now, we have this prototype patient here, 55-year-old patient with mild progressive dyspnea on exertion and fatigue, a case of congestive heart failure, history of chronic illness, type 2 diabetes for 3 years, hypertension, dyslipidemia for 7 years, all fertile soil, common soil hypothesis, past history of recurrent urogenital infections, no family history of TVD. He is on metformin, atorvastatin, telmisartan, and sitagliptin 100 mg OD. Examination wise, BMI okay, BP okay, clinical examination, bilateral PD edema, slightly elevated GBV, all signs of CHF, baseline lab investigation, glycemia target, not ideal, fasting plasma glucose, the same as I told you, plasma. Not ideally controlled, fasting plasma glucose 210, and so what is our perception? Our perception is liraglutide has a low efficacy in HbA1c reduction compared to other DPP-4 inhibitors. As per your clinical experience, are there any differences in the HbA1c reduction among the DPP-4 inhibitors? I am sure you must be wondering whether in this patient, what kind of DPP-4 inhibitor we can use, and what will be the best DPP-4 inhibitor in this scenario. So, there has been a meta-analysis of 83 randomized controlled trials comparing the efficacy of DPP-4 inhibitors in patients with type 2 diabetes. It's not a head-to-head comparison. What I want to tell you is that liraglutide had an HbA1c reduction of 0.74%. What was the gold standard when it was compared? Sitagliptin, 0.75%. It was better than vildagliptin and sitagliptin. What about gliptin? They are used in immunotherapy or in combination with metformin. What about their HbA1c reduction capacity? It is the same whether they are used in monotherapy or they are used in combination with metformin. There is no difference. Significantly, HbA1c reduction with liraglutide, whether used in monotherapy or in combination with metformin, always remember, higher the baseline HbA1c, more is the HbA1c reduction. For example, if the baseline HbA1c is 11.8 and you are using liraglutide in monotherapy, it's to the tune of 3.5%. If you are using in combination with metformin and at a baseline of 11.8, the same HbA1c baseline reduction is to the tune of 3.7. If the HbA1c is 12.2, then the HbA1c reduction is to the tune of 5. So it's huge. What about liraglutide has a higher efficacy? Just a minute. So liraglutide placebo controlled HbA1c reduction whether it has a higher efficacy in Asian patients, yes. This has been a study done in Japanese, Asian, and white population. The HbA1c reduction in the Japanese population is 0.87, while the HbA1c reduction in the Asian population is 0.9, while in the Caucasian, the white population, it was 0.52, and 60% of the Asian population that was studied over a 24-week period was the Indian population. So there is almost a 2-to-3-fold increased old ratio of HbA1c goal achievement whether you use linear leptin in combination with metformin as compared to metformin alone. So DPP-4 inhibitors in their the classical DPP-4 inhibitors that have been in practice are linear leptin, taxa, CETA and tanylic leptin. And what I would like to highlight is that DPP-4 enzyme bending affinity is highest with linear leptin, and it is probably lowest with tanylic leptin. Not many studies have been done with tanylic leptin, very small studies in the Japanese population. What about the dose adjustment? It's not required in linear leptin. It is required in ceftagliptin, required in sitagliptin. It is not required in tanylic also, but there is a potential for hepatotoxicity if you continue to use tanylic in unmonitored doses. What about the dose adjustment in hepatic adjustment? It's not required in tanylic. Ceftagliptin, you have to be careful when you are using cytochrome P inducer sitagliptin. It has no experience in severe hepatic impairment, and there is no experience with tanylic as well. So the only molecule that actually has been studied is the tanylic. So what the perception, the dose adjustment with other DPP-4 is not a major clinical challenge. What could be the clinical impact of an unlicensed dose? So what does it mean? It means that what about the dose adjustment of other DPP-4 inhibitors in various conditions as compared to, we know by now that linagliptin does not require any flexibility of dosing. Once you start it, you continue to use it in the same dose, irrespective of hepatic or renal impairment, there is absolutely no problem. But so what is the evidence? The evidence is that nearly half the patients on DPP-4 inhibitors received unlicensed doses, whether in UK study or in the US study. So what was the important thing? The important thing was that since people, nearly half the patients were on unlicensed doses of DPP-4 inhibitors, it was actually correlating with a lot of issues, whether it was mortality, renal issues, or other issues. So what was happening? The all-cause death was increasing by 12%. Severe hypoglycemic episodes were increasing by nearly 20%. And emergency department visits and admissions were increasing by nearly 8%. So DPP-4 inhibitors, the various DPP-4 inhibitors, mild, moderate, or severe ESRD, in linagliptin, you don't require any dose adjustment. With sitagliptin, you need to come down from 100 to 50. In moderate and in severe, you come down to 50. In ceftagliptin, from 5, you come down to 2.5. In vildagliptin, from 50 mg twice a day to 50 mg OD. And tanylic, although you don't require a dose adjustment, the problem is with QT prolongation, liver enzyme elevation, and serum potassium elevation. So linagliptin offers convenience of a single dose, a simple method to maintain patients on licensed dose without dose modification in CKD. Now, we understand that liver disease as a consequence of diabetes due to glycosylation, NASH, fibrosis, cirrhosis, biliary disease, complication of diabetes therapy, it's not only about the kidney, it's also about the liver. So 80% patients with cirrhosis have glucose intolerance. And therefore, it is important that we understand that what kind of DPP-4 inhibitors we can use in hepatic impairment, and whether those DPP-4 inhibitors that we are using will be effective in hepatic impairment. So what is the perception? Gliptins are not safe in patients with hepatic impairment, right? So we have this study here, whether we have healthy, mild, moderate, or severe patients, that is severe according to the child PUG scoring, and we have patients with hepatic with hepatobiliary disorders and no hepatobiliary disorders. And what is the conclusion? The conclusion is that you do not require to adjust your dose of linagliptin, whether it is a mild to moderate hepatic impairment or severe hepatic impairment. With sitagliptin, you do not require any dose adjustment with mild to moderate hepatic impairment. It has not been studied in severe hepatic impairment. With vildagliptin, please understand, it has never been recommended even with mild hepatic impairment. Sertagliptin, you do not require a dose adjustment either with mild, moderate or severe. The problem is that when you are using concomitantly cytochrome P inducers, then you cannot use this medicine. With linagliptin, it has never been studied in severe hepatic impairment. The only drug that stands out, that only DPP-4 stands out, is the linagliptin. So, to summarize, linagliptin, whether it is high CV risk, heart failure, or high kidney risk, it has a proven safety in high CV risk, as proved by EMPA-REG. It has a proven safety in heart failure, and it has a high kidney safety. So the convenience of OD dosing without the need for dose adjustment has been proven by robust evidence that the molecule has behind it. So simplifying type 2 diabetes treatment with gliptin, it has proven effectiveness and safety in a close range of patients, no need for dose adjustment, even in chronic or hepatic impairment, long half-life, more than 100 hours, ensuring effective 24-hour glycemic control. Right, so this is, I would say, probably the last slide, and we have to understand, if you understand this in the context of the COVID-19 pandemic, the drugs that we are conventionally using, sulfonylurea, ACE inhibitors, diuretics, metformin, ARBs, NSAIDs and SGLT2 inhibitors. Remember it by the acronym called the SAD-DEM. The SAD meant, you know, these medications should be temporarily stopped during acute illness that can cause dehydration or acute decline in renal function. Once the person is feeling better and able to eat and drink, so for 24 to 48 hours, then these medications should be treated. What I would like to understand and drive home the point is that from this SAD ban, if you see the only group of drugs which is missing is DPP-4 inhibitors. You do not have to worry about DPP-4 inhibitors, even in the context of a severe pandemic like the COVID-19. So it is one molecule which can be given. The other molecule, of course, which can be given, but with strict monitoring, is insulin. It is a preferred agent for control of hyperglycemia in hospitalized sick patients. So I would like to thank you, all of you, for your patient listening, and Dr. Anil Gupta sir and Dr. Sanjeev for being my partner in crime as always. And over to you, Dr. Anil Gupta sir, and over to you, Dr. Sanjeev, to carry forward this message further and to drive home the point that this is probably one of the best molecules to be used even in the context of the COVID-19 pandemic. Over to you, sir.
As usual, another masterly oration from Dr. Chauhan. So very lucid and informative presentation. Thank you, sir. The second speaker today is Dr. Sanjeev Gulati. He is a thought leader in this field of nephrology. He is a wonderful clinician and has helped my umpteen number of patients in their hours of crisis. Dr. Gulati has got a very illustrious background. In the past, he has served as an additional professor of nephrology, Sanjay Gandhi Postgraduate Institute of Medical Sciences, Lucknow, and as associate professor of nephrology at McMaster University, Canada. He has received many academic awards. Presently, he is chairman nephrology at Fortis Institute of Renal Sciences and Transplant, Basantpur, and Fortis of Sports Heart Institute of Okla, New Delhi. Now I request Dr. Gulati to deliver his talk and enlighten us. Dr. Gulati, please.
Thank you, sir. Good evening, everyone. Dr. Sushil, I think you'll have to unshare. I need to share my slides, I think.
Okay. I will stop sharing.
So I think it's a great privilege today to be a part of yet another PDFID meeting, and again partnering with Sushil Chauhan. And I have to be very honest that I've learned a lot of my diabetes there in these meetings. And Sushil, as usual, has done this, played a marvelous inning today, made my job very easy to, you know, do the tail ending work. So I will be giving you, he's already given you a renal perspective, but I'll be just adding to you as a nephrologist. But first of all, my favorite quote from late President Kalam took Wings of Fire. The quote is by Alvin Toffler, and it says, the illiterate of the future are not those who can't read or write, but those who cannot learn, unlearn, and relearn. And the COVID pandemic has, you know, given us yet another opportunity to unlearn our past practices and relearn and learn newer ones. And how it's so very relevant that this molecule linagliptin, that how it has emerged as really one of the frontline agents, very safe agents to be used during this. And in that sense, I think, again, the medical fraternity, I think, is the most learned of the lot. Even during the COVID pandemic, where people were scared inside, sitting in their home, glued to Netflix, we have not only been serving our patients, we have also continued to update ourselves as to what are the best practices to be followed during this pandemic. The numerous guidelines have come, we have continuously updated ourselves. So, diabetes, we all know, is the commonest cause of chronic kidney disease. My own paper, way back when I was in Sanjay Gandhi PGI in 1999, we were among the first to highlight that it has emerged as the commonest cause of stage 5 chronic kidney disease. In a paper published in Renal Failure, subsequently the R study was validated by other studies from PGI Chandigarh, or Indian Institute of Medical Sciences, Dr. Manish Sok from Polo Chennai, everyone agreeing. Although at that point our paper was not accepted in some of the leading journals, international journals, because they questioned our data, saying that, you know, diabetic kidney disease cannot be seen in India because it's a disease of the rich. But yes, now it is established beyond doubt that it's the commonest cause all over the world, one of the strongest predictors of mortality in patients with diabetes. It occurs obviously as a multiple pathogenic pathway, but hyperglycemia is the root cause, so it plays a major but not exclusive role. And about half of all your patients with type 2 diabetes are going to land up in chronic kidney disease. Now, kidney disease is a risk factor it's a greater risk factor than for mortality than a prior cardiovascular disease. So this is prior MI here, all cause mortality. And let us say this is diabetes. So if you have chronic kidney disease, the mortality increases. And if you have diabetes and chronic kidney disease, the mortality increases several fold further. So I think this is very important to counsel our patients that they need to take chronic kidney disease, even in its earlier stages, very seriously if they want to stay alive, as simple as that. So two times higher risk that you see if you compare with previous MI. Now, this is patients with type 2 diabetes and kidney disease have a higher mortality rate than without kidney disease. Not a surprise, no kidney disease, 4.1 mortality. It increases to fourfold if you have just microalbuminuria. It increases 6 times if you have impaired GFR, and it increases 10 times if you have a combination of albuminuria and increased GFR. So look at the prognostic value of this. So prevention is better than cure, and for preventing, we need to understand what is the connecting link between cardiovascular disease, chronic kidney disease, which contributes to the excessive mortality. So type 2 diabetes causes chronic kidney disease. There is hypertension, there is microalbuminuria. Hypertension itself is a powerful independent risk factor for worsening of kidney disease. 3/4 of cardiovascular disease is there in diabetes, which is attributable to hypertension. And the microalbuminuria, end-stage microalbuminuria, all contribute to the mortality that is being seen in this disease. Now let's look at some of the avoidable complications, something which we are scared. And one is the risk of hypoglycemia, and it increased several fold in patients with chronic kidney disease. So this is patients of diabetes without any chronic kidney disease, this is diabetes and chronic kidney disease, this is no diabetes and no chronic kidney disease for as a baseline reference. If you have chronic kidney disease, even without diabetes, you have a higher risk of hypoglycemia. And here you have diabetes without chronic kidney disease, it increases further. And if you have diabetes and chronic kidney disease, no surprise, the risk of severe hypoglycemia nearly doubles if you had, if the diabetic patient has normally, as compared to those who have normal function. So these patients need much more careful monitoring and follow-up, and obviously our prescription also, you know, needs to be carefully tailored in these patients. Now let's look at how things have changed during COVID time. There's been unquestionable evidence now across the board that people with diabetes have had far worse outcomes in this COVID pandemic. Because of its tropism for the B cells, it might also cause new onset diabetes or sustained hyperglycemia. There have been papers where the people who are pre-diabetic became diabetic. How does it do that? There is a beta cell damage, there is cytokine storm, hyperglycemia, worsening metabolic control. New onset diabetes has also been reported, which again, all this leads to obesity, inflammation, coagulation, disturbances, hyperglycemia, DKA, old age, further worsens, comorbidities like hypertension, cardiovascular disease, renal disease, all contribute to the excessive mortality in these COVID patients. Now let's look at the outcome of COVID-19 among hospitalized patients with non-dialysis kidney. So even if these patients are not on dialysis, and there is this is no CKD, and this is mild CKD. CKD this is stage 2, this is 3, 4, 5, and as you can see, between mortality is progressively increasing. So just minor lifts in the creatinine, mild eGFR declining is a prognostic marker for poor outcomes in COVID-19 patients. This is patient without AKI, and as you can see, the moment they have AKI stage 1, stage 2 or stage 3, the mortality increases several fold. Now, let's look at the challenges which are there in optimizing glycemic control in CKD. So dose adjustment or cessation may be required for declining any function, there is clearance of insulin. So insulin needs to be monitored, and we need to monitor for hypoglycemia, and any coexisting drug which adds to hypoglycemia should best be avoided, more so during COVID time. Reduce even the gluconeogenesis is there with declining renal mass, and the management of glucose levels is particularly challenging in these patients with the concomitant need to avoid hypoglycemic agents and managing renal comorbidity, often accompanied by cardiovascular and other significant comorbidities. And these challenges have been met with several fold in patients who develop COVID. Now let's look at what is the evidence that's there. Now, Carbolina, I think, stands apart from all other, you know, gliptin trials. We had the SAVOR TMI, the TB trial, the sexagliptin, the examine trial, the eleglyptin, the TCOS, the sitagliptin. The Carbolina was, as you can see, the number was among the largest, but it was the only, also the only one which looked at renal outcomes. So Carbolina, they were pre-specified, educated, competent renal endpoints like sustained end-stage kidney disease, sustained reduction renal death. And Carbolina was specifically designed and specifically powered. The renal safety and potential benefits of nesgliptin have been proven beyond doubt with Carbolina. The perception that all BP4 inhibitors are kidney safe, it is not exclusive to linagliptin. It may always not be true because we don't really have good evidence. And what could be the clinical impact of pre-prescribed renal endpoint safety evidence as reported from the Carbolina trial? So what's the opinion? Let's look at that. Now, linagliptin has proven safety and efficacy across the spectrum of chronic kidney disease. So really you have a one-size-fits-all approach. So whether you have mild renal insufficiency, whether you have moderate renal insufficiency, severe renal insufficiency, end-stage kidney disease or dialysis, or even following kidney transplant, same dose. If you find very reassuring. I find it very reassuring in my practice. And also, you need to remember that the kidney damage, eGFR, is a moving target, more so with this COVID infection. So if you're using genicopin, it is one less headache to, on your side. You know, this is the cardiovascular safety of BP4 inhibitor patients with kidney disease has been appropriately studied in the Bombardino trial. This is the baseline risk induced for inhibitors with cardiovascular outcome. This is eloglustin. As you can see, vildagliptin probably had in this Tamlina trial had the most patients with kidney disease. 74% of these patients had some degree of kidney disease. So the evidence with vildagliptin is far more robust than with any of the other gliptins, as far as EKG is concerned, the safety and efficacy. Now the Tamlina demonstrated beyond doubt the long-term kidney safety with linagliptin. There was, however, no difference as end-stage kidney renal death or more than 40% eGFR. So there was no worsening, there was no improvement. There was a pre-specified microvascular outcome, that is, there was significant benefit as far as reduction of microalbuminuria is concerned and albuminuria progression is concerned. And these two are actually surrogate markers, and I am sure that if these patients are followed up with the Tamlina trial for a longer period, we'll find some evidence of benefit there. Because the study, I don't think, was adequately powered to look at these two hard outcomes. But these two, the benefit as well as pre-specified microvascular component outcome and albuminuria progression was very, very reassuring. So this is the risk of reduction for albuminuria, 14% lower risk of progression of albuminuria, 50% greater risk of regression in the urine albumin creatinine rate, but more than 50%, I think very, very reassuring outcomes. So this is the original article on the efficacy of linagliptin versus placebo on cardiovascular kidney outcomes in nephrotic stage proteinuria and type 2 diabetes, the Tamlina randomized trial, and the study can prove it that individuals with type 2 diabetes having a high disease burden, linagliptin reduces their albuminuria burden and HbA1c without affecting the cardiovascular kidney disease. So it is efficacy and safety. Now let's go back to the lab and look at some possible mechanisms. Why is that linagliptin is different from the, all the other gliptins? And the answer lies in the study paper which was published in Science Reports 2020 by Numa et al. And there's other articles in Journal of Hypertension. And it has been shown that what linagliptin does is it inhibits the endothelial to mesenchymal transition and thus slows the diabetic kidney fibrosis. Now, fibrosis is an irreversible process as far as renal pathology is concerned, whether disease progression is concerned. And this study shows that linagliptin forward, not linagliptin, limited this mass, looking for low factor and higher use DP4 activity and endothelial mesenchymal transition. So, renal protective effects of linagliptin, which are unique to this drug but not to the class, are the inhibition of podocyte injury and apoptosis, which has been very elegantly demonstrated with my study, inhibition of myotoph, fibroblast transformation, and increased GLP-1 receptor expression. And the clinical counterpart we have already seen in the Tamlina trial. So this is a Renalis study, the effect of linagliptin on fasting hemodynamics. After 8 weeks of treatment, overweight type 2 diabetic patients without renal impairment, linagliptin did not affect the GFR, peripheral renal plasma flow, or any intra-renal hemodynamic factors compared to linagliptin. It was shown with moderate natriuretics, possibly mediated by the SPF1-alpha, with increase in the fractional excretion of sodium and potassium, and you know, any a diuretic-like effect, a mild diuretic-like effect, nevertheless, which could definitely aid in your better blood pressure control. So this has already been alluded to, that it is only 5% renal excretion as compared to the other gliptins, which is recommended from 75 to 87. It definitely will require dose modification, continuous eGFR monitoring. In contrast, linagliptin, just give it and forget it literally, as I have said earlier. with its unique mode of elimination. Then it can only be DPP4 inhibitor that does not require dose adjustment at any stage of renal impairment. Linagliptin is useful only in type 2 diabetes. The perception is there, and it is useful only in type 2 diabetic patients. If you get any opinion regarding the same, then we leave it for discussion. Now, these are the two landmark trials. So, Karamina looking at low cardiovascular risk and low kidney risk, as opposed to which was had a follow-up of 6.3 years, as opposed to Carmina, which had a longer follow-up of 14.35 years. Most of the other trials, as you can see, fall at this end of the spectrum. Definitely no kidney risk, but maybe high cardiovascular risk, but now not high renal cardiovascular risk. So these two are essentially complementary, and linagliptin therefore tells you that it is useful across the board, not only in your high risk patient with kidney disease, but also in your low cardiovascular risk and low kidney risk patients. So all patients across the board. So they provide evidence across a broad spectrum of type 2 diabetes, disease duration, cardiovascular and kidney risk. So whether you can initiate early, initiate advanced disease, I think Lina is the way to go, Lina together, Carmelina and Karina have demonstrated long-term safety across the cardiorenal risk spectrum. As you can see, both of them have shown that there is unquestionable safety. This is the Carmelina study looking at patients of type 2 diabetes, cardiovascular disease, and as compared to placebo. This is 3-point MACE. This is the heart failure. So there was no worsening of the heart failure. They were setting at rest some of the earlier concerns with molecules like sitagliptin. And there was no worsening of kidney disease. And there was some amount of beneficial effect, as you can see in the subgroup. So we had an eGFR of 45, although the overall analysis was not there, but definitely microalgebra reduction was there. So no increases for cardiorenal events, and even in older subpatients. So linagliptin has the broadest clinical evidence of DPP4. Sushil has already said, so just for the sake of repetition and reminding everyone, proven safety, in whether it's high cardiovascular risk, heart failure, or high kidney risk. So the one dose fits everyone, regardless of age. So the young, the middle-aged, the elderly, normal kidney function, mild, moderate, severe kidney disease, dialysis patient, or transplant patient. Any cardiovascular risk, ethnicity, definitely Asian and Indians, as Sushil showed, probably greater beneficial disease duration. As we saw, both Carmelina and Carolina, regardless of the disease duration, background therapy, BMI, it has got a long half-life, so once daily dosing is sufficient, no need of dose adjustment, and proven effective. So these are the recommendations for the prevention, mitigation, containment of emerging COVID-19 pandemic and hemodialysis centers. As you all know, the COVID-19 played havoc there. So the mortality across the dialysis patients were as high as 25-30% of these patients. And the dialysis patients should be instructed to stay at home while off dialysis on their non-dialysis days. Treatment in waiting areas should have good air conditioning, ventilation to remove particles and aerosol, 2 meter separation between dialysis stations, and minimizing the comorbidity, one of which is obviously good glycemic control. And it's been really a challenging time for us in the last 1.5 years to manage our dialysis patients, to manage the high mortality as we said. And these are the guidelines here for screening of hyperglycemia and every patient admitted with COVID-19 by the Ministry of Health and Family Welfare. And the guidance to that initiating more than 90 diabetes trials patients. You will be expected to have diabetes at admission. And as I showed you, that there are both these agents, linagliptin as well as insulin. The other gliptin, yes, but there are concerns about the kidney function. So, end on this note I hand over the podium back to our special chairperson.
Thank you very much, Dr. Gulati. Another masterly presentation from you. Now the house is open for the questions, please. Any questions, please?
I think there is one in the chat box coming from Dr. Sunil Kapoor, and he says that I am concerned about Klinefelter-Wilson syndrome. Yes, we are all. And what is the take on Klinefelter-Wilson syndrome? Is, you know, the proteinuria that is happening, and as I showed you that linagliptin, the mice data shows that it is effective down at the cellular level. Acts on the podocyte, reduces fibrosis, and reduces proteinuria. So that way, this drug I think is unique amongst its the entire class.
And Dr. Closing remarks then.
Hello, Dr. Murali. No, I was just saying. If somebody has a microalbuminuria and a creatinine of say 1.3 and weight of say 85 kg, it comes to around 60 to 89 eGFR. You know, can these patients be given low dose, you know, ARBs?
Oh, absolutely, absolutely. There's no doubt that if
how frequently potassium should be monitored?
See, I think the best. I think a very practical question. The best way to assess you should monitor is that you should monitor about roughly about 5 to 7 days after initiating therapy. And whatever hyperkalemia is going to happen is going to happen very early on. And at the same time, counsel your patient, regarding the need to avoid high potassium foods. And once they are through the initial 5 to 7 days, I think then a periodic 1 month follow-up is all that we do, and then we can space it out depending on the patient's profile.
And if the bicarb of these patients is within normal range, say 24 to 27, should they be given nodosis?
Yeah. No, I think we target, because the moment you are going to give sodium bicarbonate, it's going to worsen the hypertension. So if the bicarbonate is already in the therapeutic range, then there's no point. But yes, even if the bicarb is 21, they should be given nodosis. So any value above 22 is what we target, and obviously we need to titrate for it.
Should they be given extra calcium?
No. Absolutely no role of extra calcium. You should monitor the calcium phosphate product, and if the calcium phosphate product is more than 55, you should actually stop using the calcium containing phosphate binders, because then you have the dystrophic calcification that is happening in the heart, which causes, has been shown to increase the cardiovascular mortality in this patient. So we are using a lot of non-calcium containing phosphate binders in this patient nowadays.
Thank you.
Dr. Anil, can I say
my hello? Yes, please. Dr. Mathur, kindly please go ahead.
Good evening, everybody, once again. Yeah, this is a lovely presentation. The masterly position as Dr. Arena said by Dr. Sushil as well as Dr. Gulati. We really enlightened by your talk. Yeah, this is the doctor, they say Lina, Lina, and this guy put there. The other part I want to ask is, particularly in COVID patients, those who are already in a compromised kidney state, they have been diabetic for a long time, and they've been compromised the kidney function test, their creatinine is about 2.2 or something like that. In that case, insulin is bad to be continued to control the glycemia and the control of the linagliptin and some insulin therapy. They were on metformin before, but we have stopped the metformin then now. So how to manage for long-term perspective in these cases who are kidney compromised, who are diabetic, is borderline up and down, and COVID, of course, they not did have COVID, but the fear of COVID is always remains there.
So
the guidelines
of that front. So if they don't have COVID, I think we would just stick to what they are doing. We would not talk the boat so much. But the moment they have COVID, I think all these drugs should be off for at least a month. Post COVID also, we are taking these patients off for a month because the appetite is poor and they get dehydrated. there's a lot of weakness that is happening, and suddenly linagliptin is the drug to be introduced. Obviously, as Sushil said, insulin is equally safe and efficacious, needs to be titrated very carefully. Short-acting insulin, I think, initially, to make sure that you don't get into hypoglycemia.
Thank you, sir. Just to compliment both of you for a lovely talk, we are really enlightened by your talk. Thank you, Dr. Adesh, for long.
Please give your closing remarks.
I think there has been a very good question from Dr. Patul, sir. You know, this pandemic of COVID-19 has introduced another to our diabetic patients. And as I mentioned, the question of the doctor, some molecules as I summarize it, and they are sulfonylurea, SAA, diuretic, and metformin, and ACE inhibitors. And so we have to be very careful with certain molecules. There are two with treatment of diabetes. There are some diabetes that come on, with much bother monitoring. Management of to tide over the crisis of COVID-19. Must be careful with the medications and molecules that lead to dehydration and can give rise to or vulnerable to lactic dosing. So we have to be careful with those molecules. I think it's a game of 2, 3 to 4 weeks. If you tide over that crisis, your usual medication, unless of course you are dealing with a syndrome of long COVID, which is very careful now. This is a dimension to COVID called the long COVID, in which people have sickness for a very long time, and therefore be careful using treatment of these, especially with comorbidities. If the comorbidity happens to be renal, then maybe we have to be extra careful, and we need to be in of Dr. Sanjeev Kulati. So otherwise, if the normal continue and not too much issue of weakness, dehydration, etc., then we can continue with the molecules, especially linagliptin and insulin. The other molecules of you must monitor very, very carefully during this time. We know that if the increased mortality, morbidity, as was shown by the paper by Dr. Amrish Patel, and in a tertiary corporate hospital. Therefore, if you can be careful during that period, I think after that, it is things back to normal. So during 2 to 6 weeks, you have to be careful. That is my advice to everyone. Please monitor your diabetic therapy during this acute phase very, very carefully. And I think from the long experience, Dr. Anil Gupta, sir, you would agree that you must have seen during April and May and some part of June, when we were struggling, you know, managing our diabetic patients, some of whom had COVID, that the sugars were getting above the roof.
And never before, because this time we use the steroids like anything.
Yes, sir. Exactly. And I am not going into the detail of the COVID treatment for the rationale of using steroids, but the fact was that we were dealing with very high sugars. Yeah. And therefore, we have to be extremely careful using our strategy, devising our strategy for diabetic control.
So,
that's my take, sir. Over to you, Dr. Gupta, sir.